Hello, everyone. Welcome to Encountering Chinese. Ghostly stories from Strange Stories from a Chinese Studio. The story I'm going to tell today is called Luocha Kingdom and the Sea Market. Ma Ji, whose courtesy name was Long Mei, was the son of a merchant. He was handsome, graceful, and not only that, he had a deep love for literature and the arts. He enjoyed singing and dancing and often performed with traveling theater troupes. Sometimes, he would wear beautiful fabrics on his head, making him look like a charming young girl. Because of this, people also called him the handsome youth. Ma Ji was also talented in his studies. At the age of 14, he passed the county-level examination and became a scholar, making him quite famous in his hometown. However, at this time, his father, being old and weak, had to give up his business and live a leisurely life at home. He often said to Ma Ji, "All you do every day is read books, but what good are those books? They can't be eaten when you're hungry, and they can't be worn when it's cold. Wouldn't it be better for my son to take over the family business?" So, Ma Ji listened to his father's arrangement and began to learn about trading. One year, Ma Ji set out on a business trip with his servants on a ship. However, in the middle of the journey, they encountered a hurricane. The ship was blown off its course and lost in the vast sea. After drifting for many days, the ship finally arrived at the shore of a strange city. When Ma Ji got off the ship, he saw people on the shore with strange and ugly appearances. He thought they would admire him, but to his surprise, they ran away in fear, shouting, "It's a demon! A demon!" Witnessing this, Ma Ji was also filled with fear. However, before long, he realized that the people on the shore were afraid of him, and he decided to take advantage of this to scare them. When he saw someone eating, he rushed over, and the person fled in panic. Hungry and unable to resist, Ma Ji grabbed the leftover food and ate it haphazardly. After satisfying his hunger, he wandered aimlessly forward. After an unknown period of time, Ma Ji arrived at a small mountain village. The people there also had peculiar appearances, but some of them looked more human-like, though they were dressed in ragged clothes, resembling beggars. Tired from the journey, Ma Ji sat down under a tree to rest. The villagers were afraid of him and dared not approach, only watching from afar. As time passed, they discovered that Ma Ji seemed not to be a demon and wouldn't harm them. Gradually, they approached him cautiously and attempted to communicate with him through language of partial understanding and gestures. Therefore, Ma Ji enthusiastically recounted his background, and the villagers were delighted. They told their neighbors that the visitor didn't harm people. However, those with the strangest appearances still feared him and kept their distance. The ones who came closer mostly shared some resemblance to Ma Ji in their features. They even prepared a sumptuous feast for him. During the banquet, Ma Ji asked the villagers, "Why are you all so afraid of me?" An elder among them replied, "I heard from my grandfather that, 26,000 miles west from here, there is a country called China. The people there have very peculiar appearances. Now that I've seen you, I believe the legends are true." Ma Ji inquired further, "Why is this village so impoverished? I hope my question isn't impolite." The villager responded, Our country doesn't value literature. They only care about appearances. Those with the most beautiful looks become high officials. Those with slightly less attractive looks become local officials. Those with even lesser looks become servants for the wealthy, trading their labor for food to feed their wives and children. People like us, who are ugly, are believed to bring misfortune to families. Many parents would abandon such children. And those parents who can't bear to abandon them would only let them have children and then abandon them. Ma Ji asked. What is this country called? The villager answered. It's called the Great Luocha Country. The capital city is about 30 miles away from this village. Ma Ji asked the villagers to take him to the capital city to see it for himself. So, early the next morning, the villagers led Ma Ji on the journey to the capital city. After daybreak, they arrived at the capital city. The city walls were made of black stones, and there were many tall buildings inside. However, the roofs were rarely covered with tiles, but instead with red stones. If you picked up some red stone fragments and ground them on your nails, they would turn into red powder, just like cinnabar. At that moment, officials emerged from the palace, and they all got into magnificent carriages. A villager pointed to one of the officials and said to Ma Ji, "That's the Prime Minister." Ma Ji followed the villager's direction and saw that the Prime Minister had ears that were turned upside down, and his face had three nostrils. Not only that, but his eyelashes were so long that they covered his eyes like curtains. Then the villager pointed out several other officials and told Ma Ji who they were. Ma Ji noticed that these people had peculiar appearances and were extremely ugly. However, as their positions decreased in rank, their appearances became less ugly. Not long after, Ma Ji decided that he didn't want to stay in the capital city and wished to return to the village. As soon as the people on the streets saw Ma Ji, they screamed and ran away, as if they had seen a monster. The villagers tried their best to explain, and only then did the people on the streets dare to stand at a distance. When Ma Ji returned to the village, news of the strange visitor spread throughout the Great Luocha country, and both adults and children knew about him. Many officials clamored to see him and sent invitations to the villagers, hoping Ma Ji would visit them. However, as soon as he arrived at each official's house, the gatekeepers would shut the doors. Both men and women would secretly peek through the cracks in the doors, observing and gossiping. Throughout the day, no one dared to receive Ma Ji. The villagers suggested, "Not far from here, there's an official who used to represent our old king on diplomatic missions to foreign countries and has seen many strange things. Perhaps he won't be afraid of you." So, Ma Ji decided to visit this official. When the official saw Ma Ji, he was indeed delighted and treated him as an esteemed guest. The official appeared to be in his 80s or 90s, with bulging eyes and thick, curly beard, resembling a hedgehog. The official said to Ma Ji, "Several decades ago, I was commanded by the king to go on diplomatic missions to many countries, but I never made it to China. Now that I'm over 120 years old, seeing a person from China in my own country, I must report this to our king. However, I have retired and haven't worked at the court for over 10 years. Tomorrow, I will definitely go to the Imperial Palace on your behalf." The two of them chatted and laughed, and the official treated Ma Ji with the utmost courtesy. During the banquet, they were halfway through their meal when the official brought in a dozen songstresses to sing and dance for them. These songstresses were extremely ugly. They covered their heads with white cloth and wore long red skirts. Ma Ji couldn't understand the lyrics they sang, and the melody was also quite strange. The official watched the performance and listened to the music, thoroughly enjoying it. He asked Ma Ji, "Does China also have this kind of music and dance?" Ma Ji replied, "Yes, we also have songs and dances." The official invited Ma Ji to sing a Chinese song, so Ma Ji tapped on the table and sang a tune. The official listened to the song and happily exclaimed, "It's truly strange. I've never heard this song before, but it seems so delightful." The next day, the official brought Ma Ji to the imperial palace and recommended him to the king. The king gladly accepted the recommendation and granted an audience with Ma Ji. However, at that moment, two or three ministers expressed their concerns to the king, stating that Ma Ji looked strange and they feared it might startle the king. Ultimately, the king decided not to meet Ma Ji. The official was helpless and could only inform Ma Ji that the king would not see him. The official invited Ma Ji to stay at his home, and he resided there for a long time. One day, Ma Ji and the official got drunk while drinking. Ma Ji then smeared coal on his face and began to perform a sword dance, impersonating the Three Kingdoms era general, Zhang Fei. The official was delighted and thought it was splendid. He said, "Please go to see the Prime Minister with the appearance of Zhang Fei. The Prime Minister will surely be willing to invite you to be an official. Not only that, but he will also reward you generously." Ma Ji laughed and said, "Oh, I can do it as a game, that's fine. But how can I obtain a position and wealth by altering my appearance?" The official insisted that he should do so, and Ma Ji reluctantly agreed. The official arranged another feast, inviting important officials who were currently in office to their home, while Ma Ji waited with his face painted with coal. Before long, the chief minister arrived, and the official asked Ma Ji to come out and greet the guest. The chief minister was astonished to see Ma Ji and said to him, "This is really strange. I remember you looked very ugly, but now you have become so handsome." The chief minister and Ma Ji then joyfully drank and chatted together. After the banquet, Ma Ji began to sing and dance, and both the official and the chief minister applauded loudly for his performance. The next day, the chief minister took Ma Ji to the imperial palace and recommended him to the king. The king was delighted and sent a messenger to invite Ma Ji. After meeting the king, he asked Ma Ji how the king of China governed the country. Ma Ji detailed everything, which greatly pleased the king. Consequently, the king held a feast in the palace to entertain Ma Ji. While the festivities were in full swing, the king said, "I heard you are skilled in playing music. Could you play something for me?" Ma Ji immediately stood up and began to dance. He imitated the style of the great Luocha country's songstresses with white silk wrapped around his head, and he sang a song while dancing. The king was overjoyed by Ma Ji's performance and immediately appointed him as a junior official. From that moment on, Ma Ji often attended the king's private banquets and received the highest honors from the king. As time passed, the officials in the court began to suspect Ma Ji's disguised appearance. Wherever Ma Ji went, he could see people whispering and intentionally keeping their distance from him. Ma Ji felt isolated and became uneasy. He then requested retirement from his official position from the king, but the king didn't agree. Instead, the king granted him a short-term leave of 3 months. Ma Ji took a carriage loaded with gold and jewelry and returned to the mountain village. The villagers knelt down to welcome him, and he distributed the wealth among the people he had good relationships with. The villagers were overjoyed. They said to Ma Ji, "As humble commoners, we must repay your kindness. Tomorrow, we will go to the sea market and find some precious treasures to repay you." Ma Ji curiously asked the villagers, "What is the sea market?" The villagers replied, "It's a market in the sea where the mermaid gather to sell precious treasures. Merchants from neighboring countries also come there for trade. However, getting there is not easy, and it can be dangerous. Sometimes, ships encounter hurricanes and storms halfway through the journey. As an official, your life is particularly precious, and we can't allow any harm to befall you. You should entrust us with your money, and we'll buy valuable treasures for you. The sea market will start in a few days, and we need to prepare to set sail." Ma Ji asked when they would depart and decided to accompany the villagers to the sea market. The villagers tried to persuade Ma Ji to cherish his life, but he said, "I used to travel across the sea as a merchant. How could I fear the wind and waves?" After a few days, many red birds appeared on the sea, flying back and forth. Ma Ji and the villagers loaded their money onto the ship and prepared to set sail. The ship was large enough to hold dozens of people. It had a flat bottom and high railings, requiring a dozen people to row together to move the ship forward. The ship sailed quickly. In just 3 days, they arrived near the sea market. Ma Ji saw many tall buildings not far away, and the harbor was filled with boats of all sizes. He and the villagers disembarked and found the market bustling with business people selling their sparkling and rare goods. Ma Ji was excited by the sight. At that moment, a young man on horseback dashed towards them, causing people in the market to avoid him. Ma Ji asked the villagers who he was, and they replied that he was the third son of the East Sea Dragon King, often known as the Third Prince. The Third Prince passed by Ma Ji and stopped, looking at him, and asked, "This person doesn't seem to be from neighboring countries. Who are you?" His servants ran up to inquire about Ma Ji's identity. Ma Ji bowed to the prince and explained his situation. The Third Prince listened and happily said, "Since you came here and saw me, it means we have a destined connection. Let me give you a horse. You can come with me." Ma Ji then rode the horse with the Third Prince and left the market, arriving at the coast. As they reached the shoreline, their horses neighed and jumped into the water. Ma Ji was extremely frightened and yelled in fear. However, at that moment, the seawater split open on both sides like two tall walls. They rode their horses onward into the sea, and before long, Ma Ji saw a palace. The palace was adorned with seashells, and the roof tiles were made of fish scales. The whole palace sparkled, and the walls reflected people's shadows. Ma Ji followed the Third Prince into the palace. He saw the Dragon King seated in the center of the palace. The third prince said to the Dragon King, "I was wandering in the market and met a scholar from China. I brought him here to meet you." Ma Ji hurriedly stepped forward and bowed to the Dragon King. The Dragon King smiled and said, "Mr. Ma, you are obviously a talented person. Your writings must be even better than those of literary figures like Chu Yuan or Song Yu. I would like to ask you to write a poem for my sea market. Please don't refuse me." Ma Ji agreed to the Dragon King's request, and the Dragon King brought out the most precious paper and brushes for Ma Ji to use. After writing the poem, Ma Ji presented it to the Dragon King. The Dragon King read the poem and praised, "Mr. Ma's writing is indeed exceptional. If we put your work in the market, it will surely attract more merchants to do business here. Later, I will hold a feast in my palace, and I hope you will attend." In no time, the Dragon King's palace was filled with dragon folk, and they chatted and ate, making the Dragon Palace lively. The Dragon King raised his wine cup to Ma Ji and said, "Mr. Ma Ji, I have a beloved daughter who is yet unmarried. I wish to marry her to you. I hope you'll agree." Ma Ji was surprised and delighted, and he nervously accepted. The Dragon King said something to the people around him. Soon, several palace maidens brought the Dragon King's daughter to them. Ma Ji secretly looked at the Dragon Princess, and she was exquisitely dressed, adorned with ornaments that emitted a clear and melodious sound when she walked. Ma Ji gazed at the Dragon Princess's face and found her to be incredibly beautiful. This made Ma Ji blush instantly. They immediately held a wedding ceremony in the palace. After the wedding, the princess left. Shortly after, the feast ended, and the palace maids led Ma Ji to where the princess resided. Ma Ji entered the room and saw that the large bed was carved from coral, with pearls and agates inlaid on it. The curtains around the bed were embroidered with beautiful pearls, looking extremely luxurious. The Dragon Princess was sitting there. The next morning, the palace maids came to serve them, and the princess's room became crowded all at once. After they were dressed and groomed, they went to the palace to meet the Dragon King. The Dragon King was delighted and officially appointed Ma Ji as the marriage envoy general, and circulated the poem he wrote yesterday among other Dragon Kings in different seas. The Dragon Kings from various regions sent messengers to congratulate him, and they eagerly invited Ma Ji to visit their seas. Ma Ji, dressed in beautiful and luxurious clothes, rode a blue dragon with many servants around him. The servants had their respective roles, some clearing the way ahead and some accompanying from behind. They arrived at the palace gates. There were dozens of mounted warriors guarding the gates, carrying bows and arrows and shouldering white flags, looking very majestic. On the way, someone played the zither on horseback, and someone played the flute in the carriage. In just 3 days, Ma Ji and his servants had traveled to various seas and paid respects to the local Dragon Kings. From then on, the name of Ma Ji resounded across the seas. The Dragon Palace where Ma Ji resided had a jade tree. The tree trunk was thick and required several people to encircle it. The thick bark was like transparent glass, enveloping the pale yellow core in the middle, which was thinner than an arm. The leaves resembled jade plaques, about as thick as a coin, and the fine leaf pieces hung down, forming dense tree shade. Ma Ji often sang with the dragon princess under the tree. As winter passed and spring came, the tree bloomed with beautiful white flowers. When the petals fell, they made a clear knocking sound. Picking up the fallen petals felt as if they were carefully carved, making them endearing. Sometimes, strange birds would fly to the dragon palace. These birds perched on the eaves and sang. They had golden and green feathers, with tails longer than their bodies. However, their songs were melancholic, sweet to the ear yet evoking sadness. Whenever Ma Ji heard the birds singing, he missed his homeland. So he said to the princess, "Princess, I've been away from my homeland for 3 years. I miss my parents and worry about their health. I have no way to contact them, and they don't know my situation. Thinking about all this makes me very sad. I have cried many times because of it. I hope you can accompany me back home to visit my parents. Can we do that?" The dragon princess replied, "Our world here and the human world are two completely different realms. Therefore, I cannot go with you to visit your parents. Seeing you sad also makes me sad. I don't want to take away the joy of reuniting with your parents as a husband. Let me think about how to handle this." Ma Ji was saddened by the princess's response. She sighed and said, "It seems that this matter cannot be both beneficial and without drawbacks." The next day, Ma Ji returned home. The Dragon King said to him, "I heard from the princess that you miss home. I will prepare your luggage immediately, and tomorrow morning, I will find a way to send you back. Is that all right with you?" Ma Ji expressed his gratitude and said, "As someone living in a foreign land, I am truly grateful to be favored by you. I am willing to do all I can to repay your kindness. Please allow me to temporarily return home to visit my parents, and I will find a way to return to the Dragon Palace." In the evening, the princess prepared a farewell feast for Ma Ji. Ma Ji said to her, "Let's set the date for my return. You can decide when I should come back." But the princess replied, "Our feelings as a couple will end here." Ma Ji was shocked and asked why. The dragon princess said, "You are a filial person, and you need to take care of your elderly parents. Life's gatherings and partings are as short as a single day or night. Crying like a little girl now won't change anything. From now on, I won't marry anyone else, and I don't want you to marry another either. Although we will be separated by distance, we will still be a couple. We don't need to be together every day to be happy. Today, we make this promise. If either of us breaks this commitment, that person will have an unhappy marriage in the future. However, if you worry about having no one to manage the household chores, you can marry a maid as a concubine. There's one more thing to tell you, I'm already pregnant with your child. Can you help us choose a name for the child?" Ma Ji thought for a moment and said, "If it's a girl, we can name her Vlong Gong. If it's a boy, we can name him Fuhai." The princess asked Ma Ji to take a keepsake, so he took out a pair of red jade lotus flowers he obtained in the Luocha country and gave them to her. The princess then said to Ma Ji, 3 years from now, on the 8th day of the 4th month, you can take a boat to the southern island. I will return our child to you then." Still worried, the princess took out a bag made of fish skin, filled with jewels. She handed the bag to Ma Ji and said, "Take this bag. The wealth inside is enough to support your future generations." Ma Ji chatted with the princess all night. The next morning, the Dragon King prepared a farewell feast for Ma Ji. Before parting, the Dragon King also gave him many gifts. Ma Ji bowed to the Dragon King to express his gratitude and bid farewell. Then, the princess sat in a carriage and accompanied Ma Ji to the shore. Ma Ji boarded the shore and got off the carriage. The princess said, "Take care of yourself," and turned the carriage around, gradually disappearing into the vast sea. Ma Ji stood on the shore and watched the carriage until it was no longer visible before leaving. Since the day Ma Ji embarked on his sea journey, everyone believed he was lost forever. So, when he returned, it was a great surprise to everyone. Fortunately, Ma Ji's parents were in good health, but sadly, his wife in China had remarried. This made Ma Ji realize why the princess had forbidden him from remarrying. It seemed she already knew everything about his life in China. After some time, Ma Ji's father suggested he marry again, but he declined and settled for a maid instead. Ma Ji kept the 3-year deadline in mind. 3 years later, he sailed to Southern Island, where he saw two adorable children sitting on the water's surface, splashing and giggling happily. They were floating on the sea. Ma Ji went closer to pull the children ashore. One child laughed happily as Ma Ji held him in his arms. The other child cried loudly, seemingly upset that Ma Ji hadn't come to rescue them earlier. So, Ma Ji brought both children to the shore. Upon examining the children closely, he discovered one was a boy, and the other was a girl, both incredibly beautiful. The children were wearing lovely hats adorned with the red jade lotus flower that Ma Ji had given the princess. They carried a small pouch, and when Ma Ji opened it, he found a letter inside. The letter read, "I hope my parents-in-law are healthy and safe. 3 years have passed, and the different worlds have forever separated us. Across the vast ocean, we have no way to know each other's well-being. I miss you deeply, but we can never be together again. Sometimes, I gaze longingly from the Dragon Palace, but I know it's in vain. Faced with the vast sea, my heart is filled with resentment, yet I can do nothing about it. This reminds me of Chang'e, who left her beloved and now lives in the Moon Palace. And the Weaver Girl, who separated from her husband and resides in the Heavenly Palace. Compared to them, my situation is not worth mentioning at all. They cannot be with their loved ones, so what right do I have to complain?" Thinking of this, I found myself crying and laughing at the same time. 2 months after we parted, I gave birth to a pair of twins. They can now speak simple words and understand what adults say. They can feed themselves and survive even without their mother. So, I am giving them to you, and to help you recognize them, I've adorned their hats with the red jade lotus flower you gave me. With the children's company, it's as if I'm with you. I heard that you kept our promise and didn't remarry, which brings comfort to my heart. I, too, will keep my promise and never marry another. I no longer dress up or wear pretty clothes. In my eyes, you're just on an external journey, and I'm waiting for your return at home. Although we are separated by distance, we're still a loving couple. However, I often think that even though my parents-in-law can see their grandchildren, they have never met their daughter-in-law. It must be a regret for them. A year later, my mother-in-law will pass away, and I will go to her grave to pay my respects, showing my filial piety. Our two children have a special constitution. They won't age or die. Perhaps they will help us meet again. Lastly, I want to tell you to take good care of yourself. Reading the letter, tears streamed down Maji's face. Seeing his children in distress, he gently touched their heads and said, "Do you know where home is?" The children cried even louder, calling out for home. Maji gazed at the boundless sea, stretching infinitely towards the sky, but the beautiful princess was nowhere to be seen. He couldn't find the way to the dragon palace. Helplessly, he boarded the ship with his children and returned home, feeling despondent. Having read the princess's letter, Maji knew his mother wouldn't live much longer. So, he prepared everything needed for her funeral and found a burial ground, planting over 100 pine and hawthorn trees nearby. A year later, his mother indeed passed away. As the procession carried her coffin to the grave, they noticed a woman dressed in mourning standing by the tomb. Just as they were about to take a closer look, a gust of wind blew, thunder roared from the sky, and a torrential rain poured down. In an instant, the woman had vanished. Even more astonishing, the dead trees around the grave miraculously revived. As time passed, the children grew up gradually. Maji's son, Fuhai, often missed his mother. One day, he even jumped into the sea and disappeared for a few days, only to reappear on the shore, claiming he had gone to visit his mother. On the other hand, Maji's daughter, Long Gong, couldn't visit her mother and would often lock herself in her room, crying. One day, as Long Gong was crying in her room, the dragon princess suddenly floated into her chamber. She said, "You've grown up and should have your own husband. Stop crying all the time." Then, she gave Long Gong a coral tree, 100 pearls, and a golden box as her dowry. Upon hearing the dragon princess's voice from his daughter's room, Maji rushed in, only to find her in tears. But before long, a thunderclap sounded. After the thunder, the dragon princess disappeared again. In this story, the author portrayed the land of Luocha country with an upside-down sense of beauty and ugliness, and he viewed maritime adventures as illusory mirages. Thus, at the end of the story, the author commented, "People often like to wear masks to please others, just like Maji covered in coal ash to cater to the king's preferences. Over time, such a society becomes like hell. People also often mistake beauty for ugliness and ugliness for beauty. This situation can happen anywhere. But if this becomes the norm, one day, when someone shows their true self, people around them will be terrified and flee, just like the people of Luocha country. When everything goes smoothly, the sudden fame, wealth, and fortune are like illusory mirages. Maji can only possess them in the mirage, but he can never bring all of it to the real world." And so, we come to the end of this tale. If you enjoyed this Chinese ghostly story, please like and subscribe. We'll see you in the next episode.